This summer, a couple of our seniors, Justin and Connor, sent me an email saying that they wanted to do a TED Talk at Bedford High School this year. And I was thinking that we were going to be in a classroom with maybe 15 or 20 students and doing it during the school day during our X block. I'm blown away by the number of people who came out tonight and the lineup of speakers that we have for tonight. So I want to thank all of you for coming on behalf of Bedford High School and on behalf of our students. Thank you for coming on this night. This is going to be a very exciting night. My name is Henry Turner. I'm the principal at Bedford High School. I'd like to thank our sponsors, MITRE, Middlesex Savings Bank, and iRobot for their generous donations. In the spirit of when you give, your parents probably can agree with me that when you give a bunch of senior boys some money, they're going to buy a lot of pizza. So there is a lot of pizza back there for you during our breaks. But thank you to those sponsors for the generous donations for helping us making this a free event for all of us. So what is Tedx? Tedx is an independently organized division of the worldwide TED Conference, created in the spirit of TED's mission, which is to share ideas worth spreading. Here's the introductory video.
From Kenya to Colombia, from Iraq to Korea, in slums, in schools, in prisons, and in theaters. Every day, people gather at TEDx events around the world to hear the best ideas bubbling up in their communities. Today, you are part of a global conversation about our shared future. So what is this TEDx? TEDx is an initiative of the TED Conference, a nonprofit devoted to ideas worth spreading. We grant TEDx is an initiative of the TED Conference, a nonprofit devoted to ideas worth spreading. We grant.
So as I said, we have a wonderful lineup of speakers, some who have experience speaking in events like this, and some where this will be their first time on the stage. This is an exciting way of sharing information, sharing ideas, so I hope that we walk away learning as well as being able to share beyond this. Without further ado, I think we're ready for our first speaker. Our first speaker is Reggie Gibson. He is a poet, songwriter, author, educator, and performer. He is a former National Poetry Slam individual champion and has been named Chicago Tribune's Artist of the Year for excellence in poetry. He has also been featured on HBO's Def Jam Poetry and NPR and nominated for a Boston Emmy. Please welcome Reggie Gibson.
Great, there's a lot of people out there. You ought to look around and see how many people there are out there. Justin, thank you guys for putting this together. Really, you did a great job. So things like this, the spreading of ideas, right? Kind of, when I think about that, I think about our species. It's a curious biped that we are. 7 billion of us rolling around this blue-green stone, careening through the heavy, mysterious black. We're the last hominid standing, right? And it's interesting to think about how we spread those ideas, what we did, how we did this from nothing. And we used to gather ourselves together around fire, and someone would play a drum or beat on a log, and we would have meat dripping from our teeth, and we would talk about, any vegetarians in the house? Okay, I'm sorry. We had tofu. We hunted the great tofu beast down from Trader Joe's in the frozen food. And we sat around and we spread ideas with each other. We took those ideas and they spread out across the planet. And so I guess that is who we are. It's what we do. We can't help but do that. So this first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to ask you guys for a little help. Let's do what our ancestors used to do. We'd sit around and someone would speak and the tribe would talk back and we would know we were not alone. So when I do like this, I just need you guys to give me one word. So I'm not going to work you too hard this evening. Just one word, one in Anglo-Saxon interrogative gruntable. Yes, the word is what, right? So which is a very important word because it's how we all get here. What do we, who are, what are we? What does it mean to be here? So let's try. What? All right, and for the teenagers out there, I want you guys to really muscle in your incredulity. Like you don't believe what I'm saying. Like, what? You know, let's try it.
What?
All right? I like that. So let's take it back to the dawn of time. Before technology tamed our lives, when a man took his hands and began to clap. And that was the beginning of the boom, boom, bap. Let's take it back to the dawn of time. Before technology tamed our minds, when a woman started humming to an animal's call. And that was the beginning of the yes, yes, y'all. A yes, yes, y'all. Yes, yes, y'all. It's like that, it's like that, it's like that, y'all. It's like that, y'all. It's like that, y'all. It is. According to ethnomusicologists and social linguistics, we are that, and that is the way it is. So, once again, here we are again, needing to feel what it means to be skinned. And now what are we going to do? Let's take it back. Let's take it back to the dawn of time, before technology tamed the mind. A man took his hands and began to clap, if that was the beginning of the boom, boom, bap. Let's take it back to the dawn of time, before technology tamed our minds. When a woman started humming to an animal's call, and that was the beginning of the yes, y'all. A yes, yes, y'all. Yes, yes, y'all. It's like that, it's like that, it's like that, y'all. A yes, yes, y'all. A yes, yes, y'all. It's like that. So, as I said, once again, here we are again. Needing to feel what it means to be skinned. To feel the systole and diastole getting rolled into poetry, music, funk, pop, and soul. We know the body has intelligence, which the intellect cannot dismiss. A consequence of biocultural experience. But to take a quick trip and get a sense of what it means to be a human being. Back in a time which we cannot recall, our ancestors drummed in the hum of night, up under the same stars they believed were gods, shining down as they danced by the firelight. Their bodies casting shadows, voices grunting, imitating animals they knew they would be hunting on the next day to provide sustenance for the tribe. This was a ritual intended to recognize life is born of death. Like sunrise and set cycles from east to west, the drums repeat, feet began to step. The men leapt as the chants began to rise from the women's breath. This is why music and poetry and these things called the blood has been this way since we crawled from the mud. An ancient thing banging in the body and mind we've been proving to since the dawn of time. Let's take it back to the dawn of time, before technology came to mind. A man took his hands and began to clap, if that was the beginning of the boom boom bap. Dawn of time, before technology tamed our minds. A woman started humming to an animal call. If that was the beginning of the yes, y'all. A yes, yes, y'all. Yes, yes, y'all. It's like that, it's like that, it's like that, y'all. A yes, yes, y'all. A yes, yes, y'all. It's like that. Irish or English or Spanish, Danish or Swedish or Polish, Russian or Turkish, Italian, German or Kurdish, Japanese or Assyrian, Japanese or Armenian, Portuguese, Hungarian, Hebrew, Zulu, Bavarian, no matter. The tongue you speak, every language has a beat, the body instinctively translates into music. What science has found is we are creatures of sound. Our ears need to see rhythmic patterns of human speech, like the words we speak and hear the rhythm, the sin of the movement before you get the intervening content of kicking. You first trumpet, nothing other but the verbal percussion. Drums the sound of you and then your blood being instruction. Your pulses get to throbbing, head and hips are bobbing. Feeling the effect of vocal rhythm has been plotting. The gap you can synchronize, alpha waves to realize. Rhythm for the music, a struggle is underlined. Every atom, the plasma, scattered from Saturn. Everything that matters, organizing rhythmic patterns, which are architectonic. Everything has a tonic, everything has a cycle, everything has a funny. Life depends upon it, we're engineered to want it. The thing that remains, we bring combat incarnate. The thing that haunts like a ghost in the mind, we've been dancing with since the dawn of time. Let's take it back to the dawn of time, before technology came down our minds. A man took his hands and began to clap, and that was the beginning of the take it back to the dawn of time, before technology came down mine. A woman started humming to an animal call, and that was the beginning of the yes, y'all. A yes, yes, y'all. Yes, yes, y'all. It's like that, it's like that, it's like that, y'all. A yes, yes, y'all. A yes, yes, y'all. It's like that. It's called One Piece at a Time. And this song features a protagonist who works inside of a factory, a cat rat factory, and he finds himself unable to afford the products of his labor. So what he figures he's going to do is he is going to steal a cat rat. And he's going to do it one piece at a time. So what he figures is that it'll take him a long time. He'll take a carburetor out one day, he'll take a muffler out the next day, a steering wheel, and he'll be able to put this thing together after some time, and he does. It takes him about 20 years. He starts it up, he's driving his car down the street, and everybody's looking at him like, dude, what kind of car is that? And he proceeds to tell them it's a 51, 52, 53, 54, 55, he keeps going for 90 seconds. And it hit me at that time that, you know what, that car is a lot like this country. To all of these disparate parts from all these different places that somehow we think they shouldn't fit together, but they do. And as they say where I come from, sometimes the product is shown up ugly, but somehow it stays on the road. So this is, I guess, for us, this 300 million person tribe, calling ourselves Americans, still trying to figure out how we're going to fit together and what we're going to blend into. Yeah. Story to a woman with looks I've never seen before, but she seemed to have much charm and style and grace. Well, she stepped to the counter and she ordered a drink. It was an iced cappuccino with soy, I think, but I was preoccupied trying to surmise her race. It seemed she wasn't quite white, she wasn't quite black, she wasn't quite this, she wasn't quite that. In fact, I guess she wasn't quite anything, I suppose. Now, I didn't want to harass her or come off crass, but the question was burning and I had to ask, and she said, save your breath, I can guess what you want to know. See, everywhere I go, folks stare at me, trying to decode what I'm supposed to be, but truth is, mister, calculating me ain't so easy as you can see. So, since you've got the interest, I'll take the time and stop that question from smoking your mind. Just buy my coffee, I'll tell you just what I be. So, I said, no sweat. That's a bet. I'm always curious to know about what I don't know yet. And for me, that was worth a cup of joe, or maybe even two. So, I pulled out my money, paid for the coffee, and said, now, there you go, honey. Now, tell me, girl, what in the world is you? But that's when she took a deep breath. And she went, well, a Jew, Italian, Asian, American, African, Asian, Mexican, Puerto Nigerian, Brazilian is what I am. And I'm meant to fit like a patchwork quilt and grow my sweat to take country milk. But keep it simple, stupid, call me American. Now you can just call me American. And just call me American. Though sometimes I ain't quite sure just what that means. But from sea to shining sea, there's 300 million bees. Red, white, and blue, and every in between. Come on, guys. Democracy, about what makes ours different than the ancient Greeks. We go to subjects most folks will tell you is taboo. We talk about love and religion and politics, the Taliban and the Dixie Chicks, Democrats, Republicans, and them green rainbows too. We spoke about President Barack Obama, talked about Congress and all this drama, and wondered whether or not our economy's really bouncing back. Like, whose fault is gonna be when our climate changes about trucks and such and good shooting ranges and why I prefer PC, but she likes Mac. Yep, we act so much about track time. And as we talked, we began to find that she and I was quickly becoming friends. Then she looked at her watch and said, "Up, gotta run. Thanks for the talk, I've enjoyed it, hun. Who can say maybe one day we'll see each other again?" Then as we both shook hands, said no more, she grabbed her purse, headed toward the door. That's when some dude looking real confused comes over real slow. He's like, "Say, buddy, seems like you know that woman. You mind very much if I ask you something?" I said, "Save your breath, I can guess what you want to know." And at that point, that's when I took a deep breath. I went, Asian, American, African, Asian, Mexico, being Puerto Nigeria, Brazilian, what she am. And she's meant to fit like a patchwork quilt, and from her sweat to hit country milk. But keep it simple, stupid, call her American. Now you can just call her American. You can just call her American. So sometimes you ain't quite sure just what that means. But from sea to shining sea, there's 300 million cheese. Red, white, and blue, and every in between now. You can't just call us Americans. Call us Americans. Though sometimes we're not quite sure just what that means. But from sea to shining sea, there's 300 million weeds. Red, white, and blue, and every in between. Red, white, and blue, and every in between. Red, white, and blue, and every in between. Pretty close to that beautiful, hulking behemoth that overhangs us all, Boston. And it took me a long time to fall in love with this city. A long time. 10 years, in fact. And then one day, and some of us here might have that same experience. So this is Boston, a very reluctant and unlikely love. You must forgive me, I must get to my, since we're so close to Concord, I must get to my transcendentalist and Emersonian heroic stance. Because that's how you're supposed to rock it when you're a poet in New England. Boston. Oh, Boston. I dig you, baby. No, I'm more than dig you, I dig. Big dig how every night you make the stars and street lamps fight for the right to light you. Big did you being part of asphalt, glass, and rubber, that cute little way you have of making both clean hands and dirty work your lover, how each year you go once more unto the academic breach with your army of educators fighting to teach your hard-headed students. Some of who get groggily foggy every night, working late by dim desk light to scale the menacing heights of your formidable scholastic walls. Boston, I big dig each and every all of your taverns. Those towny caverns where both blue and white collar gather to holler out their dreams. Know what I mean? Look out your myriad windows, Bean. Big dig the scene of all those who, like me, fell in love with you so many years ago. Big dig them out there on the corners, freezing to death on the corners. From Mattapan to Wonderland, Jamaica Plain to the Cambridge border, big dig them out there on your streets, in their cars, getting lost on your streets. If streets are what they really are, I am starting to believe you when you tell me they're really paved over cow paths that somehow seem to have some laughable sort of chaotic order. Boston, girlfriend, baby. See, I have noticed lately that as you and I take a walk along the common, you seem to have this inordinately Brahmin-like need for power, the need to see and glower at the human race through a face wet and beset with 17th century sweat, and you really seem to like telling people, no, 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 not you and not yet. And when I first got here back in the early days and didn't quite understand your wicked, wicked ways, that made me upset. And I still get more than a little myth at the fact that your state house never seems to miss nor lack new ways in which to tax. Or whenever I try to call you to complain about it, your phone is never on. Or whenever I used to want a blue, green, red, and orange line swing to get my room on, you often sing, your tea trains would refrain at 1 in the morning. 1 in the morning? Come on! Then would come the dawn, when your freshly coffeed head begins its rattling hum. And I can't stay mad at you for long, especially when I can feel you stirring next to me, yawning awake by the underlight that breaks on a feasty, piercing as fiercely as the beating of bagpipes and the beating of Afro-Celtic drums. Boston, you are one curious mix of Beacon Hill will and Mass Ave muscle. Dot-ab bustle to calm-ab moan, wash your woman, student, and cab driver's hustle, singing your freshly minted immigrant songs inside of these crazy, amazing, oncoming days of giftily drifting New England snow. So yeah, Boston, I dig you. Even though there are days you could be a real pain in the back, bae, I got to say, I dig you. Big did your artists, designers, musicians, and writers, and these crazy, crazy poets like myself who you keep on inviting or creating, like some seriously therapy-needy mother whose love both nurtures and smothers her children and others, even though all the while your dirty water keeps on. We'll be right back. We have one more, then we'll be out of here. This is for those of us who question. Got any fellow poets in the house? You see our armpits, don't be ashamed. Okay, good. Then you know that we've only been talking about two things. Everything we write is about Eros and Thanatos. Love and death. That's what it's all about. Thanatos, death, he's got everybody here on GPS. We're hoping it pings somebody else before it pings us, right? We're hoping for that Eros, that love, before we get out of here. There'll be a word in this next song. This last one is called Thanatoi. Thanatoi means those who must die. It's an ancient Greek word.
And, you know, I was a size 16. And I was wearing a brace. That didn't help them, thanks. And I also did the worst thing ever. I fancied the boy in the year above, the popular boy in the year above. Who was I to want to fancy him? So what I used to do is spend, the bullying happened in lessons as well. So at break times, I used to hide in the gym changing rooms, just for a bit of respite. And I remember saying to my friends, well, I say friends, when I came home, you see, school for a lot of people is where the fondest memories are made, lifelong friendships are made. But for me, I had one friend that lived in the police housing estate that I lived at, and my brother, my little brother. And it was the three of us, and we were the three amigos. And that was my time where I would just look forward to going home to spend time with my family and my two closest friends. When we were starting to think about where we would go to university, the first thing I could think of was where's the furthest possible place so I can guarantee that there won't be anybody I know going to the same university. I was filling out my UCAS form or filling out the university application, and when I was in the library and somebody said to me, "So Stacey, where are you going?" I was an average school achiever. The reason for that, not for my lack of wanting to learn, but the fact that they were picking on me, so I was always preoccupied trying to ignore them. I said, "The University of Leeds." They turned around and said, "Nice try. I don't think they're going to accept you. They're not brainy enough." I said, "Well, we'll see." A couple of months later, my parents dropped me off at the University of Leeds. And thank you. Thank you. And I remember my mum and dad closing the door. They dropped me off. And I sat on the bed and I thought, bloody hell, I'm here, now what? I don't know what to do. And then I realised what Mum was saying when she said I was a little bit special, in the fact that now I've learnt I'm an introvert. So as you can imagine, standing up in front of you all is kind of my worst nightmare. But, you know, but I did volunteer, so I've only got myself to blame. But I remember sitting there thinking, like, okay, what to do now? And I just thought, I'm an introvert, or at the time I didn't know that, but I thought, I like my own company. I actually don't mind it. I like who I am. And I'm much more of a small group type of person. And I was far happier watching TV and watching, you know, kind of Eddie Izzard or watching Labyrinth. And some of you may not know what that film is. It's David Bowie. It's pretty amazing. Yeah. So I was in my room and I just thought, right, I'm here. Right, I need to get a grip. And I always used to say to myself, get a grip, Sarge. So I think it's my worst nightmare. Freshers week, please. Forced fun. Happen to introduce yourself. No, it wasn't a great time for me. But the reason I chose the University of Leeds was not only because it was miles away from home, but it was also a chance for me to study abroad. They had this option where you could apply to either study in Europe or in the US. Straight away, I'd been to Europe, but the US, I'd only ever seen it in films, especially New York. So I thought, why? The US it is. A couple of semesters later, I went to my tutor and I said, "Miss, I would love to apply for New York." She turned around and said, "Stacey, I think we need to concentrate on your grades." I scraped into University of Leeds and I was realising I was way above my head. I wasn't sure that I could do it. But I said, "But Miss, this will really help with my confidence." And she said, well, she reluctantly gave me the application form. I applied, had the interviews, and then I had a couple of weeks later a call saying, "Stacey, can you come to the faculty office?" So I walked and I thought, well, you know, I gave it a go. At least I said I tried. At least I could say I tried. So So I was walking, I thought, do you know, so many people in life will tell you you can't do something, but if you believe in your gut that you can do it, then bloody go for it. Because ultimately, why are you waiting if you truly believe you can? Even if you don't have the grades and you really truly believe you can do something, then I would stress and say, yes, you can do it. Go to faculty, go to whoever. But anyway, so I sat in the room and I thought, right, here we go, let me listen to it. And they turned around and said, you're the only person that's been accepted to study at Marist College out of your academic group, and my own group, the Bachelor of Arts in Marketing. I said, I'm sorry, what? And they said, you've been accepted. I thought that's what you said. And I remember walking out thinking, bloody hell, wow. Because the thing is, if you don't go for something, your no's will always be no's. You have to seek out for a yes. So I remember being at Heathrow with my parents, and I had my mum, dad, and my brother, and they were waving me off to go. And I thought, I am not going to return the same person. I just knew it. My mum was bawling. Oh my God, my daughter, so proud of you. My dad, stiff upper lip, red eyes, that was enough for me. I could tell he was emotional. And my brother stood there tall and proud. My little brother, for the first time in his life, could be really proud of his big sister. So I walked, I arrived at JFK. I was hounded by immigration because I'd lost the form on the plane. Don't ask, my dad killed me. And I was like, I just want to study here. Well, that went down well. But suffice to say, Marist changed my life in every possible way. One, the lessons were incredible. I'd never seen so much energy in a lesson before. I had made the most amazing friends. For the first time in my life, I felt liked, accepted, and proud of who I was becoming. So, saying goodbye was the hardest thing I had to do. But I arrived home and everybody I loved could tell I had changed. When I graduated from university, that courage that I found within myself and that newfound confidence that I had, it took me on journeys that I could never ever have had imagined. For one, I was an expedition leader in rural Africa, where I used to send 16 to 18 year olds from the UK, used to go over to rural Africa and help on community projects, build schools, build watering wells. We'd also do wildlife projects, where we'd actually stay in the safari parks and things. It was incredible. And I remember seeing these students look up to me, and I thought, if only you knew, when I was your age, just quite what a quivering, shy wreck I was. Also within, that made me realise that whatever I put my mind to, I can actually achieve it. And that's my message to you today as well. Whatever you want to do, don't let anybody tell you you can't do it. Because if you truly believe it within yourself, you will make it happen. So I continued on that vein, and I worked with big companies such as Pepsi and Apple, and I thought that wasn't big enough for me, so I decided, with no media experience whatsoever, to apply for a job at the biggest, largest Hollywood film studio in the world, and that was Universal Pictures. Suffice to say, the girl from Northamptonshire sat in the reception area watching all these brand new movies on the screen. I thought, I think there might have been a mistake. You know when you pitch yourself so high, you think, okay, I definitely pitched myself way above what I thought I'm capable of. Whatever they saw in that interview, they absolutely loved. And I had the most amazing 18 months in that role. Loved every second. I then moved on to Paramount Pictures, where I was the budget analyst for the theatrical department. So what that means in English is that I walked on the red carpets, and every single premiere that you see in the UK and Ireland had to go through my purse strings. I had a corporate credit card in my name of nearly £500,000 each month. I would share the carpet with Brad Pitt, Angelina Jolie, Hugh Jackman, Russell Crowe, Emma Watson, you name it, I've pretty much walked beside them. Until I was about 30, I just turned 30, and two things happened in my life. The first one, bullying doesn't stop at school. It happens everywhere. It happens in the workplace, and it happens in the home. It happened to me again in the workplace. I'm here to have a voice to say, it's not okay to bully, and it shouldn't be seen as, oh, well, your personality is there, your personality clash, or you just don't get on, don't worry about it. When people are being mean, they reject you, they don't include you in things. That's not right, and it shouldn't be accepted. And I'm here to say that you're not alone if ever you've been bullied or are being bullied, or realise that you are a bully yourself. Have a think about the courage that's inside of yourself and why you're bullying that person. Because more often than not, you're bullying somebody because they're different, because they think slightly differently. Instead of quipping them or putting them down, ask them why, ask their opinions. Because more often than not, they're the most interesting people you'll ever come across. Secondly, I just turned 30, I had the glitzy job, everyone was saying that's such a dream job, but you know, I was unfulfilled. I'd always wanted to help people, but I didn't quite know in what capacity. And also at that point, after being bullied in the workplace, my confidence again had taken an all-time low. I made it my promise and my vow to work on myself, and that's where I discovered self-development. I think, and I truly believe, that every single person should spend at least half an hour a day asking themselves, how do they feel? Acknowledge that. Are you doing what you truly want to do? If not, how can you go about doing it? And it was at that point, when I was discovering myself, that I realised that I started my mission to help others be the same. I'm here to inspire possibilities and to ignite confidence. Whatever you want, you can have, you can achieve, you can do. It just takes you to take that first step. People can show you how. It's up to you, though, to decide. You all matter, and you all have a special gift. I don't care if people say that's all. She would say that. She's all a bit dreamy. But it's true. You all have a special gift, and it's up to you to discover it, work at it, and show it to the world, and not to be afraid. There'll always be people to tell you you can't do something, but it's up to you to have the strength to show it. I would also just like to take this opportunity to do two things, because I'm not sure how I'm doing with time, because there's no clip at the front like I've seen on YouTube, so I'm a little bit panicked about how long I've taken. Two things. So first of all, please come, you all raise your two fingers this way, please. And if you could just touch, either find your pulse, I'm hoping you all have one. And secondly, I'm sure they're not as fast as, your heartbeats are not as fast as mine right here, right now. Okay, you should be able to feel something. Okay, beat, beat, beat. Every single one is not guaranteed. The next one is not guaranteed. Secondly, I've got a little surprise for you all. I'm going to give you all $86,400. I know. And you can come every time. And I'm going to give it to you every single day, okay? That's pretty amazing. I can already guess on what I'm going to spend mine on. Okay, but there's a catch. As with most things in life that are pretty too good to be true, there is usually a catch. First catch is this. Every single day you have to spend it. You can't save it, and you can't give it away to anybody else. Where would you go? What would you do? Who would you see? Who would you be with? What would you spend it on? What would you invest it in? And I'm going to turn it around slightly and say this. Each and every one of us has 86,400 seconds in a day. And I would still ask you those questions. What would you do? Who would you be with? What would you invest in? Thank you so much for allowing me this space, and good night. Thank you.
Good to know that I'll be getting a check at the end of this. Our next speaker is a teacher, social justice education activist, and the current president of the Holyoke Teachers Association. He was hired by Holyoke Public Schools in June of 2014 after speaking out against the district-wide initiative to post student test scores publicly on walls, a practice known as data walls. Following an investigation by the Massachusetts Department of Labor Relations and now pouring on public support, he was reinstated in November of 2014 only to be fired again. I think that district said fired earlier, not hired. Only to be fired again at the end of 2014-2015 school year. Here to speak to us today about education, please welcome Gus Morales.
Good evening, everybody. So yeah, I fired twice. I want to make sure we got that right. Not hired, fired, 2 years in a row. But that's not what we're here to talk about today. What we're here to talk about today is teaching. It's something that's very, I'm very passionate about. So the first question is, what does it mean to be a teacher? It seems like an important question. I get asked that question quite often, and I'm sure any teacher in the audience has been asked that question. What does it mean to be a teacher? But what I'm here to tell you is that that's not the most important question when it comes to teaching. What is the most important question when it comes to teaching is this: why did I become a teacher? It is the single most important thing you must know if you're a teacher. For me, the answer is, I care about children. I love being around children. I want to affect the future. I want to make the world a better place than when I found it. If your answer to any of those, if your answer to that question is anything but what I have just said, you're in the wrong profession. You shouldn't be teaching. Teaching, number one, is about the children. So let's talk about that. Let's talk about scripted pedagogy and why I'm even talking about any of this. Scripted pedagogy is the robotic sense of teaching. Teaching has become a chore, it's become a compliance. Teaching is no longer that labor of love that it used to be. And I have proof of this. I have proof of this in every school across the country where, you know, the kids are rebelling, the teachers are rebelling. And what we have is an age where the world has literally lost its mind. When we consider students, what we care about is data. What we care about is test scores. What we care about is compliance. No longer do we concern ourselves with the well-being and the social emotional well-being of a student. We concern ourselves with, how is this student performing on a test? How is this student complying with the objectives, with the standards? And so we're not doing what we're supposed to be doing. And I've got an admission to make. I'm not perfect. I'm not a perfect teacher. I never have been. I'm not sure I ever will be. I'm a good teacher. I think at times I'm pretty amazing, but I would never say I'm perfect. I've made mistakes with my own students. The pain and the hurt that I sense from my own students is a pain and hurt that I take with me home every single day. And so instead of this scripted pedagogy that tells you that this is what you should be doing today, this is what you do tomorrow, this is what you do the day after, this is the score you need to get to be a worthwhile human being, instead of doing that, what I'd like to consider here is adopting an emotional pedagogy. A pedagogy of the human spirit, of that human interaction that defines what teaching really is, as opposed to a standard. Why do I care about this? Let's suppose I had 5 children. I don't have any kids, just so we're clear. Let's suppose for 1 second, though. Let's play pretend. And I have 5 children. Of the 5 children, 3 get C's and 2 get A's. Who am I most proud of? How do I pick which one I'm proud of? How about if my C students actually worked their butts off way much more than my A students? My A students just got A's because they're brilliant and they didn't even have to try that hard. But my C students, they worked their tails off. They really tried. Who should I be proud of? Do I tell them that they're worth less than their brother or sister who got an A? And the reason I bring this to you is back because that's exactly how I see my own students. I see my own students as my family. I weep with them, I stress with them, I get angry at them. As a matter of fact, that's one of the examples I want to give you. I had a student, a 6th grader, and mind you, I'm human, I'm not perfect. I had a 6th grader who'd been driving me nuts all class, absolutely driving me up a tree. And the last straw was when he poked me on the arm and he was trying to get my attention, and I flipped out. And I sent him out of my room. The second I sent him out of my room, I could see the tears welling up in his eyes. I chased after him out in the hallway. I immediately apologized and I hugged him. I made a mistake. I was the bad guy in that scenario. No matter what anybody tells you, it's never about the teachers. As a matter of fact, I would go as far as to say that we are unimportant in that overall picture. What's really important are the students, those kids in front of us who entrust us with so much, with their well-being. And I think for a lot of teachers, I don't think any of us are malicious, but I think we've lost our way. I think we've adopted a scripted pedagogy because we believe that's the best way to raise test scores. I believe we've adopted a scripted pedagogy because it's simpler than fighting back. We have an obligation. Those students who once again entrust us with their lives, sometimes literally, they deserve so much more from us than what we are currently giving. And no, I don't speak for every single teacher in the country, but I speak for a lot of teachers. I talk to a lot of teachers. I spend a great deal of time figuring out how it is that we teachers fit in this new society that values numbers over humans. It's something we have to contemplate, something that we have to figure out, especially teachers. If we allow it to continue in the same trajectory that it's on right now, which for me is downward, if we continue this, there's not going to be a teaching profession left. We're going to be replaced with robots. And I, for one, did not sign on to be a teacher in order to proctor tests, in order to gather data. I signed on to be a teacher for the reasons I already told you. I want to affect the future of this country. I love being around children. I don't care how they score on tests. Does that mean I don't want to teach them? Absolutely not. But if we start valuing how a student performs in a singular way versus how they are as a human being, we've surely lost our way. I think anybody can admit that. I have students coming to my classroom who are homeless. What do I say to them? Well, you need to get your MCAT scores up. That doesn't seem appropriate to me. What kind of a human being am I? As a teacher who's standing in front of that child, what kind of a human being am I? If I tell them, I only care about your score. The fact that you're homeless is irrelevant to me. Because I'm just a teacher. I'm here to comply. My master said, I need to do this. You need to get your scores up. There's a moment where every single teacher in this country is going to have to decide for themselves. Am I a slave or am I a teacher? And it may sound melodramatic, but if you've been watching the news, there's no melodrama there. We have a human being in this world, a billionaire by the name of Bill Gates, who sees education as thus: 100 children in one classroom, and a moderator, not a teacher, a moderator, 100 children in front of computer screens with a moderator to make sure they're on task. That is not teaching. What Bill Gates and people like that can never understand is that teaching is about a human connection. Teaching is about us and them becoming one in the classroom. In my classroom, it is never my classroom, and my students have always known this. The first thing I tell them is it is our classroom. I let them design it, I let them make the rules in the class. Because it's not my space, it's our space. And if we truly believe that, then we have to ask the kids, what is it that they want? And if we're being honest here, when was the last time we asked them what they wanted? Because I'm near 100% sure that they're gonna tell you, I don't care about the test, I don't care about this, and I don't care about that. But the adults, for some reason, we've lost our way. We've lost our way and we're peddling something that is not good for anybody. So what I'm telling you right now is that we need to shift from the scripted pedagogy that tells us that these are the standards we need to cover. And this is exactly where Johnny and Chris need to be. And if they're not there, they're failures. And if they and their friends are not there, the school's a failure. We need to shift away from that scripted pedagogy and move towards an emotional pedagogy. A pedagogy that recognizes that the most important thing between a teacher and a student is the relationship. I worry sometimes that too many teachers have adopted a philosophy similar to doctors and lawyers, an emotional vacuum where they're afraid to get attached to their students. I see this all the time, and it concerns me. They think they're doing the right thing, They think that they should have some distance between the students. I have zero distance between myself and the students. I share with them in everything. And maybe it's because I'm from Holyoke, but I share with them in everything. Their misery, their pain is my misery, my pain. For me, that's what teaching means. But collectively, as a teaching profession, if we don't shift away from being scripted and being test proctors and being robotic, we're going to see our profession fade away, and that worries me. So what I'm asking every teacher in this room tonight, and every teacher across the country, is to start thinking about that. That question, why did I become a teacher? And once again, if your answer is not because you love kids, because you want to affect change, because you want to change the world and make it a better place than when you found it, you're in the wrong profession. A scripted pedagogy is not going to help us solve any of the world's problems. But if we learn how to interact with one another, teacher to student, and far beyond that, I think we can make the world a better place. So what I ask of every teacher is to throw away the script, forget the standards, and just focus on the child in front of you and teach your heart out. Thank you.
Our next speaker before our intermission is Shree Bose. She was a grand prize winner of the first Google Global Science Fair in 2011 for her work with drug resistance and ovarian cancer. She is a current Harvard undergraduate majoring in molecular and cellular biology with a secondary in global health and health policy. She's also a STEM education advocate, which led her to create Piper, a Minecraft toolbox for aspiring engineers. Please welcome Shree Bose.
So today I want to start off by asking all of you a big question. All right, is everyone ready? Okay, so the question is, how do you get started on doing groundbreaking things? It's a question that has a lot of answers, first of all. But it was a question that was first asked of me by a 17-year-old teenager named Park, who I met during this talk in South Korea, who is this amazing student. And I have to tell you, the thing that I remember the most about Park was the fact that his hands were shaking the first time I met him. And when he came up to me, he was kind of looking down, and he would look up and then back down. And he had this combination of embarrassment, a little bit of excitement, but mostly he was nervous. And he asked me that question. He asked me, how do I get started? I really like biology, and I don't think I know enough. And I have to tell you, my first reaction to that wasn't to be very like, oh, you're great, you're gonna do great. My first reaction was to smile, because I knew exactly how he felt, because I had felt that way many times throughout my life. And that brings me to the reason I was actually there in the first place, and the reason I'm here today. It was because I found a way to answer that question for myself. So let's take it back a little bit. My name is Shree Bose. I am currently an undergraduate at Harvard. And I grew up loving science. I had an older brother who's 2 years older than me, and he was one of those people who would learn amazing things in class, and then he would come home, and since I was the only person he could boss around, he would make me sit down, and he would explain all of the awesome stuff he learned. So I remember getting lessons on atoms and molecules and cells and the way the entire world was built. I remember being amazed. I was fascinated by the way science could explain the world and how we could do experiments and discover things that nobody knew before. So I grew up with this amazing sense of the power of science. And I maintained that throughout middle school And when I got to high school, I joined freshman year biology, and I loved it. I loved learning about the different ways in which our cells operate. And it was around that time when my grandfather got sick. I was 15. I remember we took a trip to India. And the emotion I felt wasn't anger or sadness, really, at seeing him. He had cancer, affected and wasting away from cancer. It was more confusion. I didn't understand what was happening. I couldn't reconcile the pretty little pictures that you see of like a lightning bolt striking some DNA in your high school textbook with the actual person who was suffering in front of me. And when he passed away, I realized I wasn't okay with just accepting that as not knowing. And so I did what most 15-year-olds would do. I went on YouTube, and I started searching what cancer was. And the more I learned, the more I realized I wanted to know. So I would start reading scientific journals that I completely did not understand. I would watch YouTube videos late at night of different ways that cells process and different lectures. And at some point, I started realizing that the questions I was asking were the questions that current research was trying to figure out. And at that point, I realized I needed more. So I went online and I started searching for professors in my area. Literally, I would search some keywords that I thought were interesting, and then I would find graduate school professor within 10 miles of me. I literally found professors the same way you would find a McDonald's. And I did this multiple times. So I would send out an email, I would read a bunch of papers from this person, I would send out this email, and 2 days or 3 days later I would get back a reply, and I'd hold my breath, I'd click the link, and usually it would say some nice, sometimes not so nice, iteration of, you're too young, we can't take you. There was one lady who actually said, please never email me again. That was a little rough. But I remember sending out dozens and dozens of these emails, and at some point, the rejections didn't hurt that bad, to be honest. At some point, the sting was kind of out of them. I would just be like, okay, we're on to the next one. And so I continued this. It happened for at least 3 months. And for some reason, I didn't tell my parents I was doing this. I was just emailing strangers on the internet. That is not a life lesson. Don't take that. But I sent out an email to a professor named Dr. Alokananda Basu, who is a professor of molecular biology and immunology at the University of North Texas Health Science Center. And I remember getting a reply back from her, and I steeled myself, and I clicked it, and I was ready for the rejection. I was so prepared for it. And the email didn't say that I was accepted. I did not get accepted right off the bat. She said, please come meet with me so I can see how you are. What does that mean? So I had just gotten my driver's permit. I was 15, so I was really excited to be able to drive myself to this graduate school. And I went to this meeting, and I was sitting there in her office with this big shot professor, and I was 15, I knew literally nothing. And I remember my hands shaking. I remember sitting in that office, my hands shaking, looking at the ground, looking up at my professor, looking back down, and saying, I don't know that much, but I love biology and I want to get started. And it was because of an amazing mentor like her that I actually got my first shot. I got to join her lab for the summer. I did this amazing project on breast cancer and drug resistance, and I was learning new techniques and doing amazing things every day. And I broke a bunch of glassware at one point and then tried to hide it. Why not? Messed up a lot. And I remember at the end of the summer, I had this project. It was all about drug resistance and breast cancer, and I went to the science fair that I had been presenting at for years because I loved science, and it was my first ever project in medicine, in biology, and in the field that I thought I wanted to be in. And I went to the science fair, I set everything up, and I remember the kid next to me had a project that was very similar, plus like 5 years of work. And I won nothing at all. I remember I walked out of like the award ceremony hall. I started crying because I was very angsty. I wrote some poetry that was extremely bad, not up to the par of the poetry we've heard here tonight. And I remember feeling crushed, not because I had lost, but because I realized that this was a field that I really liked. And it turned out I kind of sucked at it. And that's harsh. That's harsh to realize as a 15-year-old. And I remember I spent a few months and I completely convinced myself that I didn't want to do science fairs again. I didn't want to do biology ever again. I was done. We're going to figure something else out to do with our lives. And throughout this period, I remember talking to my parents a lot and telling them about how I really liked this field and I discovered I wasn't good at it. And it was at their encouragement and at the fact that my mentor invited me to come back the next year that I went back into the lab next year. And I had the chance to develop my own project. Actually, my professor's exact words were, well, you can work with breast cancer again, or you can develop your own project on ovarian cancer. And I immediately took the chance to develop my own project. And I got to work the next summer on this amazing project on drug resistance in ovarian cancer and figuring out what happened to ovarian cancer cells to make them stop responding to drugs. And at some point throughout the summer, I was doing experiments, I was learning new techniques still, and I was holding a result that basically showed that one protein was really important in how cells were becoming resistant. And I remember thinking, this is it. This is what all of those moments of like growing up and finding the world of science amazing, this is what it's all been leading to. This is it. And so I later got to present that project at the first ever Google Global Science Fair, which was an absolutely incredible experience. And I'm very photogenic. And I got this sort of whirlwind of experiences after that. I got to meet President Obama, who is amazing and very tall. I got to speak to NIH directors, and basically I would just tell everybody about the amazing research I had gotten the chance to do. And along the way, I also got to come to Harvard, which was a great experience. I met some of my best friends there. And I also got the chance to meet people who shared my vision for doing incredible things. So in my talking to students like Park, who I met in South Korea, I would have a lot of students who would come up to me and say, you know, I'm really interested in something, and I want to do something amazing, how do I get started? That's the question, how do we get started? And for me, a lot of the students who came up to me were interested in tech, because we're in sort of a hardware revolution time, and it's a brand new world out there, and there's so much to be made. And I would have students who were interested in technology who would come up to me and say, how do I get started? And I never really had a good answer for them. So when I came across an amazing co-founder named Mark, who shared my same vision for creating something that could let kids get started with technology and building electronics, we decided to create it. So how many of you guys have heard of Minecraft? Let me see hands. I see hands. All right. So Minecraft has sort of taken over the world. It's a platform that lets you build virtually, and we decided to pair it with actually building physically. But since videos with background music are way more entertaining than me, let me show you a little video.
Piper, a toolbox for budding engineers who happen to like Minecraft. You assemble your own beautifully engraved box. You add your electronics and connect to your microcomputer, called the Raspberry Pi, to the screen.
And then we lose some sound, but I'll just narrate it. So basically, the idea is that you put together your own computer. There's a Raspberry Pi microchip, which you can build your own computer off of. And then you actually build hardware that interacts with the game. So there's a storyline. There's an asteroid heading towards Earth, and you're a robot, and you have to stop the asteroid. And basically, along the way, you have different challenges where you have to build hardware. So maybe you have to find diamonds in the game. So you build a row of LED lights in front of you that light up when you get close to diamonds and unlight when you walk away. And so there are these little interesting gadgets and interesting aspects to how we developed the game, to make girls interested, to get kids actually building with the technology without actually realizing that they were learning incredible things along the way, that make this entire thing an awesome approach to getting kids started. So I want to bring it back to the question I asked at the very beginning. How do you get started on doing groundbreaking things? And my answer to that would be mentors and tools. It would be the people who tell you when you're absolutely failing that, you know, maybe you should go back and give that lab another try. Maybe there's something there. It's the tools that you play with, and then you build something and you realize that, hey, I really like engineering. It's the people around you who lift you up, who inspire you, who encourage you, who make every step of your journey to who you are going to be all the better. And so what I want you to do today, to everybody in the audience, I know we have a lot of students out there, and this is especially applicable to you, but I think to everybody, is to really think for a second about what makes you excited. What are the things that you stay up really late at night watching YouTube videos about? Think about that one thing. Think about why it excites you, and think about what you want to do with it. And then think about the mentors that you possibly could find in those fields who might be able to help you. Because those are the people that you should be reaching out to. You should actively try to find them, because that can make the biggest difference in the world. I want you to think of the tools that you want to see in the world, and then I want you to create them. I want you to see intersections of science and technology and arts that you think can push the world forward, and I want you to be the person spearheading that effort. And when you are accomplished, as I'm sure you all will be, way, way down the line, probably, I want you to make sure that you mentor other people who are in your shoes right now. I want you to be sure that you reach out to people and make them aware that they can also change the world just like you. Because I know from my own experiences that sometimes all you need to really release groundbreaking work and groundbreaking ideas is the advice that I got from my mentor all those years ago when I was sitting in her office with my hands shaking, saying that I didn't know enough. And it was the same advice that I actually gave to Park all those years later in South Korea. It's okay if you don't know yet, but it looks like it's going to be a lot of fun to learn. Thank you guys so much.
I definitely think you held your own. Great way closing out the first half. Thank you. We're going to
our next speaker is a self-professed serial entrepreneur. He founded Plum Choice, a remote PC repair service, in his basement in 2001, and earned accolades such as Ernst & Young's 2011 Entrepreneur of the Year in the New England region, and Plum Choice grew into a booming national service with over 1,000 employees and $50 million in revenue. He's currently working on his next venture, Roostwire, whose mission is to change real estate for good through technological innovation. Please welcome a Bedford High School parent, alum, Ted Work.
I do not dance. I wish I did. I'm going to leave that to the next speaker. I was going to say that the first person tonight had some backup band. I wish I thought about the opportunity to have that, because instead you're going to be stuck with a regular PowerPoint slide put together by someone who loves business. As a prologue to my discussion, I actually want to talk to you about the power of three. If you look up in Wikipedia, it's a writing principle that suggests things that come in threes are inherently funnier, more satisfying, and more effective than other numbers of things. And my experience, and something that will come out strongly through this presentation, is it goes far beyond the definition that you see in Wikipedia. I really believe that people, in general, have a limitation of how many things they can prioritize at the top of their list. Three is the number. Three is how many things that you can have top of mind and be successful at any one time. Okay, that's the prologue. Everybody has passions. Everybody has things that they want to be very successful at. And what I want to do in this talk is give you some of the things that I've learned through a number of different directions, my passions, that I think will help in terms of being successful in yours. My passions have been my family. As you know, I'm from Bedford. It's the only thing I have on top of the other speakers. My family, I have four kids that have gone through the Bedford schools. For those of you, I know there's a lot of college-bound kids. They're all doing great. Bedford did a terrific job of preparing them. My second passion has been business. I absolutely love creating new businesses. The Plum Choice was the one that was mentioned. The new company is actually Roost Wise, not Roost Wire. So if you're trying to buy or sell real estate, look up Roost Wise. My third passion is I love to teach. I love to teach the things that I've learned. I do mentoring down at the MIT Venture Mentor Service. I help entrepreneurs wherever people have a need or interest. Because tonight is actually one of those things that really gets me thrilled. To begin to help out and provide some of what I've learned since it's been so many hard knocks getting there. So what I want to do is I'm actually going to cover things that I've learned that are a little bit off the beaten path in terms of what does it take to be successful when you really are passionate about something. And the ones I want to cover, there's a personal characteristic I want to talk about, which is not usually covered. There's some scarce resources. These are things that we all have. We don't have enough of. I want to talk a little bit about that. And then finally, the most important are the three things you need to know to manage those resources. So the first thing is, in terms of personal characteristics, everybody knows that you have to work hard, you have to be smart, you have to learn a lot, you have to be passionate in order to be successful at something. What I would tell you is there's an awful lot of people out there who are passionate, work hard, smart. If you're competing with them in any fashion whatsoever, you have to have at least one more distinguishing factor. I call it mental toughness. This is the ability to persevere when things go very bad, sometimes when things go very right, when you're down, when the situation is varied from where you thought it was going to be. It's the ability to keep your head through a situation and be able to apply that to solve the problem. I have a couple examples actually from my company, Plum Choice, and throughout here I'm going to have different examples. Our company, it's hard to know it because we are in good standing right now. There was twice that we almost went out of business. One time we were 24 hours away, and I'll talk a little bit about that later as part of the learnings, things you need to know. These are things that are devastating for business, require people to stay strong and persevere, or else you won't be, in this case, we would not have been successful. Not all things in business have to be negative to be extremely challenging. We also had an opportunity with a very large company. I don't know how many people here remember Circuit City. Circuit City is a company that went bankrupt. They're a company that went out of business, and we ended up losing 60% of our business all in one time. They also, earlier in our career with them, gave us, they asked us, we need you to go from 200 to 400 people, and you got to do it in 3 months. So imagine the stress that you have through that. In the real life, and very seasonal, everybody knows Tom Brady. This is one of the most mentally tough people that you can observe. When he's out on the field and things are down and everyone else is starting to get upset, he is always calm, cool, and collected, leading his team. If he gets knocked down, unless he's on a stretcher, he always gets up. You have no idea how hard he's been hit because he pretends like nothing has happened. Really important characteristic, the anecdote I'll say is that if you can keep your head when everyone else is losing theirs, you'll have one more head than they do. So let me talk about the two most valuable resources, time and money. There's no other commodities in business that really matter. You can solve all problems with time and money. Unfortunately, you usually don't have enough. When you look at time in a business and you start to run out of time, you can spend money. You can throw money at hiring extra people. You can make sure that money is applied in ways to try to accelerate projects that you're trying to get involved with. So there's a relationship between these two. But if you ever run out of time, you ever run out of money, you're out of business. In terms of personal life, we all are trying to juggle multiple things. We're trying to juggle family, work, friends, staying in shape. The list is quite long. Some of those things we can trade off money. We can go and hire babysitters, people to clean the house, lawn people, and so forth, to try to free up time to do some of those things. But again, even when you're dealing with any significant problem, you're faced with the deadline of, do you have enough time? Do you have enough money? So let me tell you the three things I've learned to help you deal with time and money issues. First one is focus. In our personal lives, as you know, we have 20, 30, 40 things that we have to deal with. Again, going back to the power of three, you can deal with three successfully. If you try to focus on doing 20 different things, guaranteed you will not be able to be successful. I'm going to give you a really visual example from my company. This should help explain how important it is to focus your efforts, your brain power on very specific things. At one point in time, our company managed a whole bunch of different metrics. Metrics are things that you measure in business performance that tell you how well the business is doing. There's hundreds of metrics. There are more metrics than you can imagine. This is just eight of them, and it's purposely put up there so you can see how big a rat's nest you get if you start looking at a whole bunch of different metrics. So imagine as a company, you're trying to manage all these metrics and you're trying to get everyone rallied around. Everybody gets confused. What we ended up doing is deciding there's really only three things that are critical to our business. One is subscriptions. These are people who pay us monthly money. It's gross margin, which is our profitability, how much money we make for every dollar that we earn. And then there's customer satisfaction, which is absolutely critical to any business success. We focused on these three. Everybody in the company knew this was our priority. Yes, there's a ton of other metrics that roll up to that, but everybody in the company knew exactly what was important and what they needed to do to help the company succeed at these very specific things. So that's the second thing. Focus is tremendously important to make sure you're not expending time, not expending money on the wrong things. Next thing, it's the decision you make. The decision you make are immensely good or bad on your resources. If you make bad decisions, you waste resources. If you make good decisions, you've spent it in the right direction. Data is critical. I'm a big believer that you have to do data-driven decisions. What that means is you get information, you make a decision with real knowledge, not with your hunches, not with instinct. Instinct and hunches are a really good way to make bad decisions. Quick example in your lives, if you were going to hire a babysitter, you don't get a picture and say, wow, I like that person, I'm going to go ahead and bring them in and have them take care of my kids. You go off and you get data. What's their history? Is there a Corey check? Talk to other people that might have used that babysitter. You're making sure that when you make that decision, it's the right decision for your family. In our company, when we were a $4 million business, we had $1 million a year on top of the $4 million that were invoices that went out, customers did not pay us. So we're a $4 million business, $1 million we weren't getting paid.
That's a pretty big deal when you're a $4 million business. We decided we're going to start, or we would like to charge customers in advance with credit cards. Sounds like a simple thing, it's done all the time. We called in, we'll call her Roberta, that's her name, but we called in Roberta and we said, Roberta, what do you think? You're on the phone all day long, talking to customers, you know what they're thinking. Immediately she said, terrible idea. You do this, you're going to lose more business than you would save. So instead of going with a hunch, going with an instinct, we decided to run a test. Called the next 50 customers, they called, we said, you have to pay by credit card. We didn't ask if they'd like to, we said, you have to. All 50, ended without any hesitation, provided us their information. So there was this point, there was a decision that was made, we gathered data, did the right thing, and as a result, our company revenue jumped by 25%. That's a very significant thing for any size company. The last thing I want to talk about is you need options. When you are trying to conserve resources and you want to be in control, you need to have options. Options are the different alternatives that you have in front of you that you can make decisions about. Now, I heard there's a lot of people in here who are applying to college. You know, the example I'll give to you, would you ever apply to just one school? It's pretty terrifying to think about applying to one school and hoping you'll get in. If you have a bad medical problem, are you going to just go to one doctor? You're going to be out there looking to get a couple different opinions, make sure that you're getting the right opinion, and you go with the doctor that makes the most sense for you. Very, very important that you understand what the variety of options are in front of you. I had mentioned earlier that Plum Choice almost went out of business twice. One time was because we were trying to raise funds. We were 24 hours away. We had only one source of funds for our business. And as you can imagine, someone who's going to invest in a business and they think they're the only one, they have a tremendous amount of power. If we had to do it over again, we would have had more people at the table so that we could have mitigated the risk and actually driven a much better decision with it. So that's the, those are the three things you need to know. The resources, you probably want to know what's the right number of options. It could be that if you have too many options, you start to waste your resources again. If you just have one, as you know, it's no good. The right answer is three. Thank you.
Talk reminded me of I was reading a book called Talk Like Ted, which was a book I highly recommend, which is about all of the great, the best features that they got from the most popular TED Talks Talk Like Ted. But anyways, one of the things that they talked about, some of the best TED Talks had, was the story of the power of three. That's how we remember. We remember things in threes and connect to things in threes. Our next speaker is a ballroom dancer who was a victim of the Boston Marathon bombings, where she lost her leg below the knee. In the face of unfathomable adversity, she did not falter, instead choosing to face her challenges head on by returning to the ballroom with a prosthetic limb, actively engaging in philanthropy, and appearing on CNN, Dancing with the Stars, The View, and other media outlets to become an inspiration to millions. Please welcome Adrienne Haslett-Davis.
About 40-ish people, all of whom had been survivors, not victims, of roadside bombs, some in the military and some not. And we're in this tunnel, and it's every man's dream in New England and beyond. It's the season opener for the Pats. And I'm excited, but it is every man's dream and woman's dream. And I've got my jersey on, and I'm ready. And you can see in the distance the AstroTurf. You can almost smell it like it's real grass. You can hear the crowd starting to roar. And I'm standing there. We're in groups of two, ready, dark. There are like wires everywhere. We're all amputated. We're like pulling our arms out, trying to walk, trying to figure out these wires, holding on to each other, holding on to people's service dogs. And you hear the coordinator say, 30 seconds. And I'm excited. And I'm so excited I picked out these really cute jeans that fit over my prosthetic. And I was like, yes, jeans again. Woo, Pats, woo. We get to go through the tunnel before the Pats do. It's their new tunnel. Yeah, Brady, look at that. And I'm so excited. She's like, 30 seconds. My phone starts going crazy all of a sudden. I'm thinking, and I just quickly just do one of these glance, you know, those glancing things, and I see on text, Adrian, fireworks, fireworks, fireworks. They're about to go off. Adrian, fireworks. Tell everyone, fireworks. And I scream, fireworks. And they say, be quiet. Shh, it's okay. You'll be fine. And they start going one by one, two by two. And they start announcing our names. And I walk through the tunnel. Adrian, Haslett, Davis, and they announce the name of the wounded warrior next to me. And I raise my arms in the air and I smile, and suddenly, boom, and I'm down on the ground. And I immediately get up, I pet the service dog, which I believe is totally illegal because it's a service dog, it's not mine. But I need it, and I'm using it. And I don't think she can really say anything because we both know, we both need it. She's crying, I'm crying. And I gather myself together, smile again, with cameramen screaming at me. Smile. The world is watching. I smile, I wipe the tears. Video's out there somewhere. And I keep walking, right onto the 50-yard line, gathering my breath. I've been here before. I hear the loud noises. I know what this is like. I start to have a deep breath. And then, loud noise, right? And then I hear, ladies and gentlemen, we would like to welcome to the field your New England Patriots. And all of a sudden, the crowd goes wild, we go wild, I'm a little bit calmer, people are starting to wipe their tears, some people are really losing it. And all of a sudden, we're cheering, the cameramen swarm around us to get the big group shot of all of us with our legs, and some of us on our crutches, some of us in wheelchairs. And all of a sudden, bam, 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 fireworks go. We had all told the coordinator, don't do that. Like, seriously, those are bombs, just in case you didn't know. And the only shot they got was us covering our heads. Mascara streaming down our faces. You know what? I don't care. You know why? Because we were standing at the 50-yard line, I got super close up of Brady. So I really didn't care.
I might not know football,
but I know football.
Right, ladies?
And men. And
I'm like,
okay, there's Brady, and I'm still panicking.
I'm still crying.
But I'm trying to keep myself together
because I'm used to this. See, I'm used to it.
And just then, Brady takes the ball, throws it to the end zone, touchdown, immediately, within seconds
of the game starting.
They gather us up, take us up to the box. Our family and friends are waiting, and they say, oh my gosh, I can't believe it, you were there. You were there on the 50-yard line with your feet touching the line. They had to tell you to back up, and you were right there, and you saw the touchdown. And then I heard it. I heard it from another soldier. I wasn't there, actually. And I knew what they meant. And another survivor said, I wasn't there either.
I said, neither was I. Where were you? I was in a ditch in Afghanistan. My best friend was lying bloody next to me. I was on the sidewalk near the finish line. And I said, I was lying in a puddle of my own blood, missing my left foot in front of the form. I was not on that 50-yard line. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm talking about PTS. Drop the D. It is not a disorder. There's nothing wrong with being post-stressed after having this big, huge thing happen, like having your leg blown off by a terrorist. You're probably going to be a little stressed out. It's not really a disorder. There are studies today that are questioning and dropping the D off of it. They don't believe it's a disorder. They don't feel like it should be treated as a disorder. And I don't either. I get treated for it. I have the world's best therapist. You can argue with me all you want. Mine's the best. He probably thinks I'm the best. I have job security. He has job security with me for, like, life. I mean, there's, like, problems. And you see, I was back on Boylston Street, walking out of that tunnel and thinking, there's no way they're going to do the fireworks. They're going to make a call. It's Gillette. It's Brady, right? And
they're going to make a call and they're going to stop the
fireworks. So I'm back in calm mode,
just like I was walking down Boylston Street
on my day off as a professional ballroom dancer. And I decided to watch the marathon for one block. I never stopped to watch. I only walked it. And just then, a loud boom went off. I turned around just in time to see the smoke. And there I was on the ground. I never lost consciousness. I was awake through the whole thing. I saw the smoke, my hair on fire. I looked down, my right thigh was bleeding open, scar, where they found some of the pressure cooker from the bomb
that I was standing almost over
when I was bumping shoulders with someone whose name I don't think deserves a name. Am I right? And then I looked down, and my dreams of becoming Ginger Rogers, a life goal since I was 5 years old, was gone.
I succeeded at it,
but my left foot was missing.
It was all over for me. Everything had changed. And just when I thought I had only suffered that loss, I realized in the days, weeks, months, years, 2.5 years now, 904 days, like this counting, later, there's this whole mental mess of it all. And everyone started talking about, oh, well, you have PTSD, you're never going to be the same again. And they were right. When you go through something really huge, it doesn't matter what it is. It could be huge and happy, or huge and awful, or war on the streets, on a sunny day, on a day off. You're never going to be the same again. But I wasn't prepared for what having PTSD really meant. And I started to do a lot of research. And there isn't a lot out there. I looked at military websites, which didn't help at all. I talked to the military, because I was married to a military man at the time. And they didn't really want to provide a lot of information. I later learned, as they sat on my couch telling me to be quiet about it all, and how much I was suffering, that they try and cover up a lot of stuff by inviting themselves over on Sunday afternoon, 5 minute warning, so that they don't have to pay for coverage. And it got me thinking, how many people suffer from this? So I started to do even more research. And I started to look. And PTS can show itself in many different ways. It can be hereditary. You don't have to have some big life to have PTS. You don't have to have some big moment or big explanation for why you're feeling uneasy, can't sleep, restless, wanting to reach out all of its tentacles to assess the safety and the threat level of every room you enter. I know where every exit sign is, like the two stewardess. Right? And every person you meet. Your stranger danger is through the roof. But there are many reasons that can cause this. It is not necessarily being in a military type attack, or even serving in the military. Ladies and gentlemen, this is not a result, or not a disease, and certainly not a disorder, but certainly not a reaction of the military. This is a reaction of life. When you're a child, if you're bullied, you can have it, maybe not, but you can. There are many, many studies showing it. If you are later on in life, laid off a ton, or have a very severe loss in your life, you can have PTS. The reason they keep calling it PTS, because I have this addiction for looking up things. A lot of dancing. And disorder has a very long, drawn out, as most of them do, definition. Parts of that definition and words they use to describe disorder are crazy, insane. I'll give you a few examples. Litter, like the stuff my cats poop in. Yeah, litter. You're considered litter. How cool is that? Dysfunctional. Unworthy. And my favorite, a mess up. No wonder we don't talk about it. I've looked up the definition of disabled. I'm not disabled. I can do tricks off my partner's shoulders and land on my prosthetic. Can you? Throwing it out there. I think people don't talk about PTS because they have the D on the end. And I agree with those scientists and those doctors and the psychologists and the therapists that are working hard and diligently to drop the D. Because once we drop the D, once we drop the litter and the mess up, maybe we could start having this really great conversation, right? Maybe we could look at each other and say, gosh, you know what, when that car backfired, you don't even need to say it. You hear the car backfiring and you just look at each other because you know you both have it and you go, I'm lucky I have a whole survivor community that just can look at each other when something happens and just be like, yeah, I got you. How cool would it be? There's 53 million people, only recorded cases, by the way, suffer from this. Can you imagine how many that is in the room? I was going to do that statistic Can you imagine? That means the person sitting next to you could be suffering from this and not be able to say anything. I've already had conversations in this room with people who have it, so I know you're there. And I'm speaking to you. And I'm speaking to all Americans and those around the world that are listening. You do not have a disorder. You are not a mess up, and you are not something cats poop on. You are a person. It is the after of your trauma, and you are darn right and worthy to be stressed out. You do not need your leg blown off by a terrorist to be stressed out about something that happened in your life. Life is tough. Adulting is tough work. Adulting is hard. Things happen. We have bad breakups. We lose parents. We lose loved ones. We lose friends. We see things on sidewalks. We see things on television that makes us not watch TV anymore. And yet there's a stigma. Women who have been raped are just now, starting to be recognized as people with PTS. And I say just now, meaning within the past 5 years, they're just starting conversations about it. stuff to talk about. That's exactly why we should be talking about it. There's a soldier. I was watching a TEDx talk. I don't have the permission to vote, so I won't say his name. He's in a correctional facility. And he did 2 tours in Iraq and Freedom, joined after September 11th. And he carried a pistol on him when he got home for safety. He drove in the middle of the road because he was convinced that a roadside bomb would go off if he drove on either side. One night he was at a bar and he says he blacked out. He was drunk, but he wasn't that drunk. He blacked out of rage. He saw a fight break out with a knife. He pulled his pistol and, according to the police report, meticulously cleared everyone from the room and beat someone who was in the fight and was charged with attempted murder and is serving 10 years. And you know what his message was for his TEDx talk? Talk to me. You want to do something about PTS? Have a conversation. Talk to a soldier. Talk to someone who is open enough to tell you that they have it. I have a very dear girlfriend of mine who opened up to me about it. I'm fortunate enough in my philanthropy work that I do with my group called Sister Legs, which helps amputees and others suffering and their families with seasoned amputees and myself as mentors. She was not one of them, she was a family member. And she said, you know, I really want to tell you something. I know you were once a military wife and how scary that can be. And I said, yes, it can be. PTS is tough. She said, and I couldn't relate to this degree of it. She said, he came home and he woke up in the middle of the night one night when I rolled over and he thought someone was in his barrack. And he took care of me until the action snapped out of it and heard me scream. Scary stuff, huh? Sticky, itchy stuff to talk about. I talked about it because it needs to be talked about. Because I felt these feelings of complete helplessness. And people with PTS, they don't quite know who to turn to. They have these weird, itchy feelings. I've certainly never woken up and felt like I needed to beat the heck out of someone sleeping next to me. But the empathy in me for knowing what it's like to be in war. And the gentleman from that TEDx talk said that when you're done serving, you get served a plate of PTS as your party gift. It's a tough, hard subject. And yet, it's one we're talking about. The worldwide news focused on Oscar Pistorius. I focused on it too. I focused on every amputee story. He grew up in a very, very, very rough part of South Africa. He carried a gun on him every year. And there are many that think that PTS should be used instead of insanity in court. I don't know if I agree with that, but I'm open the possibility of discussion. Because only good things can happen from discussion. Ladies and gentlemen, we who are suffering from PTS are not suffering from a disorder. We are suffering from a society that does not allow us to be emotionally honest. Right? We as a society don't allow us to be emotionally honest with who we are, what we're suffering, and how on earth do we get help? How do we start that conversation? I think we start the conversation by saying, hey, did you hear that they dropped the D off of PTSD? Think if half the crowd started that conversation with somebody that you know, whether you think they have it or not, just opens up the door. It opens up the conversation. That's my charge to you. To be kind, to be open to conversation. It doesn't have to be about the nitty-gritty dirty. I can feeling too. And I feel a darn need to give back, because the entire city and the entire world give back to all of us survivors. And are us with PTSD mad? Or PTS mad? Wow, I had the D on there. See, it's so ingrained in our brains. Are we mad that they let off fireworks? No. I got to see Brady. He's so fine. They didn't know. They didn't know. And when you get done with a birthday party and you start popping all those balloons and somebody goes running out the door and you don't quite know why, there could be a really good reason. Right? So we're not asking you to walk on eggshells. What an awful world that would be, right? We're not asking to change everyone's opinions. The one thing that we're asking for those of us that are suffering from PTS, just a little extra stressed out from the event that happened to us in our lives. That's all. It's a big deal, but that's all. Don't need to make it more complicated. We're asking you to take some time and for once, maybe once, be kind, because every single person is fighting a hard battle. Thank you very much for your time.
Angela, thank you for coming to Bedford and teaching us. I think we learned a lot from that. I really appreciate that. Our final speaker for tonight is an astrophysicist and planetary scientist at MIT whose work focuses on exoplanets. Referred to by NASA as an astronomical Indiana Jones, her work helped lead to the first discovery of an atmosphere on a planet outside of our solar system. She's devoting her life to, as she puts it, finding our Earths. Please welcome Sarah Seeger, Professor Sarah Seeger.
Good evening, everyone. Can you hear me okay? I can't tell if the mic's working. Well, I loved all the talks so far. It's great to be a part of this evening. I'm the professor who doesn't write back, so please don't write to me. No, I'm just kidding. I usually write back eventually, but I'll try to be a little nicer now, thanks to our earlier speaker. Well, so I'm here to talk to you about our universe and the stars and the chance that there might be life out there somewhere beyond our planet. And every star in the sky is a sun. And if our sun has planets, Mercury, Venus, Earth, Mars, etc., surely those other stars should have planets also. And they do. I want you to know that astronomers have found thousands of planets. And we believe that every star has a planetary system, so the next time you're able to go out to a dark sky, you can look up at those stars and wonder what kind of planet is around those stars. And when I go out to look at the stars, I wonder, is there any other life on those stars, or on planets orbiting those stars, looking back at us? And that's what I'm setting out to do, to find life on other worlds. But I'm not talking about UFOs, so please don't write to me about UFOs either. And I want to believe, but I don't believe that aliens have visited Earth anytime now or in the past. I don't believe in the ancient alien theory, for those of you who have seen that show. But I am actually astonished about just how many people want to believe, and at least a quarter or a third or even more Americans actually believe that aliens in some form have visited Earth sometime in the past or present. Or maybe they're here among us. Well, I actually do support that concept that there may be intelligent life out there, and there's the search for extraterrestrial intelligence, arrays of small radio telescopes or larger telescopes listening to the skies, hoping that someone is sending us a message directly. And recently, you may have heard that the Breakthrough Prize Foundation, via its main supporter, its main person, Yuri Milner, a billionaire, actually donated $100 million to the search for extraterrestrial intelligence by listening for signals. Well, there are three things that I wanted to mention about the search. One is it's hard to listen to the whole sky. And so far, SETI has searched for what's equivalent to one glass of water compared to all the world's oceans. The second one that weighs heavily on my mind is, what if the aliens are out there, but they don't want to talk to us? What if we're just too primitive? Think about you now. How do you feel, for example, about talking to that ant colony that's digging in your backyard? Like, do you think you'd even want to talk to them? Would you even know how to reach them? And the third issue actually is about noise. You know how when there's a lot of talking in the background and you can't quite hear things? Well, we have the same problem in radio astronomy, in all of astronomy actually. We have a lot of noise going on. And in this picture here, each of these different rows is a picture, a panorama of our sky, of our Milky Way galaxy mostly, showing you that at each different wavelength, there's a noise out there, or signal, or whatever you want to call it. Now, let's see. I'm going to see if I have a pointer here. So, oops, that's what I was worried about. Okay, so you can see down at the bottom, it's actually the second from the bottom X-ray, for example. Our Milky Way is emitting in X-rays, invisible waves, and all sorts of. So we have to actually hope that the aliens communicating to us also have the same sort of maps of the sky, and that they know where there's no noise, and that they're listening for those same frequencies. Well, I'm an astrophysicist and a professor at MIT, and in my job I use more conventional search for life beyond Earth. It's actually conventional now. It used to not be talked about. It had this huge giggle factor, like we can't really talk about aliens seriously. And in this case, I'm not searching for UFOs or evidence of them. I'm not listening for signals that aliens might be sending to us, but we're actually just, we've kind of lowered our expectations. We're just hoping there's some bacteria out there somewhere that, like bacteria on Earth, is producing gas that fills the atmosphere that doesn't belong, that we might be able to find. And I want to tell you my favorite way, out of all the ways we have to find planets, there's a lot of different ways right now. I want to tell you about my favorite way to find them. But first, I have to tell you the big problem we have in looking for planets that might be like Earth around a star like our sun. And that is that our sun is so bright compared to Earth. Our sun is 10 billion times brighter than the Earth. So that actually, I want you to think about those numbers for a moment. It would be like asking, what can you buy for a dollar? I know here across the street at Whole Foods, I don't know if I can buy anything for a dollar. But for $10 billion, it's such a big number. Like, what could you possibly conceive of even that you could spend that on? Well, our sun is 10 billion brighter than our Earth. And when we think about looking at nearby stars, we're thinking of blocking out the starlight with a special screen that could block the starlight out so we might be able to see the planets directly. But I want you to know, I actually now am tasked as a physics professor to give you a tiny physics lesson. I want you to know that if we put up a giant circular screen in space to block out a star, it actually wouldn't help. And on the top, you can see a circular, it's supposed to be a circular screen, and if we were to block out a point of light, we would see what you see on the top right. We would see these rings of light, because light acts like a wave. It's just analogous to dropping a pebble in a pond, where you get ripples. That's what it's like, blocking out a point source starlight. But those ripples in light, they're actually far brighter, 100,000 times brighter than the planet we'd be looking for. So we can't use a circular screen. But instead, astronomers and physicists, optical physicists and others have spent a long time working out very special, complicated math to actually find a special shape like the one there on the bottom left. And if you could put that giant screen in space and block out a point of light, you would actually see that image on the right. That would be like dropping a pebble in a pond. But all around the pebble, the water would be perfectly smooth, to one part in 10 billion. And all the ripples would be pushed out to the edges. And that's what we're trying to do. We're trying to build a specially shaped screen that would launch together. It could launch together with a telescope. And the petals in this specially shaped screen would unfurl from their stowed position. Then the central truss would open up, and a second stage of deployment with the petals snapping into place. This starshade, we call it starshade, it would be tens of meters in diameter. Think about like 100 feet in diameter. And it would actually have to fly very far from the telescope, tens of thousands of kilometers, so that it could block out the starlight so that we would be able to see the planets directly. It's just like blocking out that light with your hand, only it's really complicated and it's really far away in space. So with this starshade, actually, there's been a lot of work going on. And I was pleased to be able to lead a team for 2 years working on part of the starshade. And now I'm going to show you a real deployment demonstration in the lab. Oh, here's the water sample. It's you see now the petals of the starshade unfurling from their stowed position. But in this video, there's only four because it's all the team could afford to work with at the time. You see them unfurling from their stowed position. And they're actually big petals. They're 5.5 meters long. Now you see the second stage of deployment. I always get asked, why are there people in the video? It's not supposed to deploy automatically. It's showing that deployed over and over again, those petals match up to the same position within millimeters. Because it all has to be made very, very precisely in order to work at all. What we will do in the future when we launch the starshade is block out the starlight and look for the planets directly. And this is what we hope to find. It is a pale blue dot. So after all that hard work, all we're going to see is a tiny smudge. And this actually is a real picture of our own Earth, not with a starshade by an alien civilization, but it was taken by our Voyager 1 spacecraft, which has now left our solar system. But before, when it was 4 billion miles away, it took this picture of Earth. And I hope you can see the tiny little dot amidst all the redness. That red actually is scattered light in the camera optics. But we think when we look for the other Earth far away, it'll also be surrounded by some red dust, which may be due to an asteroid belt in the other planetary system. Now, from that little pale blue dot, you would not believe the amount of work we'll have to do. We'll have to, like, get out every last little piece of information. And we're going to do that by breaking up the light into colors. And many people don't, and we're going to break up the light into colors. And you know, if you could look at a rainbow very closely, you would see that some parts of the rainbow, some very specific wavelengths of colors are missing. And that's what we do in astronomy, is we break up the light, and we call it spectroscopy, and we look for a fingerprint of missing lines. And those lines are gases, actually, in the atmosphere of a planet or of a star, or in this case, of our sun. And what we want to do for look for life is we want to look for gases in an atmosphere of a planet far away. Here on Earth, we need oxygen to survive, and our planet has 20% oxygen by volume in the atmosphere. And we're not really aware of that, we just go around breathing it. But without plants and photosynthetic bacteria, we would have no oxygen in our atmosphere. So we're looking for gases like that, and we certainly hope that the aliens are out there, and they're intelligent enough to build a starshade, and they're looking at us, and they see oxygen, and they say, wow, oxygen is such a reactive gas, it's so highly reactive, it shouldn't be in the atmosphere. And hopefully they can try to piece out whether or not there's life here on our planet. But one of the things that I worry about when I don't have to worry about all, you know, the other problems that we've heard some other people speaking about tonight is I wonder, what if we're looking for the wrong thing? What if looking for these gases actually is not where we're headed, actually? What if we don't have in these other planets? What if sort of that microbial life, it lasts a very long time? But I like to wonder whether the dominant life form out there in the cosmos is some kind of super intelligent robot. You know, here on our Earth, we're still primitive, really. Yet we've had pacemakers for decades, prosthetic limbs. I read that at soon we can control limbs with thought. And we also have gene editing. I think all of you, hopefully you're not checking your phones now, but we're glued to our phones. The Apple Watch. What's next? Implants? And so it may be that this sort of time that we're here as intelligent beings is actually limited, and that we're going to morph into something really complicated in the future that's not easy to detect at all or to communicate with. So I don't know what the future holds for us, but I do know that we're the first generation here in human history that has it within our reach to find other planets orbiting other stars. And given that that signal is so tiny and we're still so confident we can find it, I wanted to leave you with the positive thought that the stars are out there for everyone, and the future is yours. Thank you.
Nice message to end the night. I'm totally blown away by our speakers. So one last round of applause for all of our speakers. As I said, when this idea came up, we had no idea what was to come. And this was to be our first event
of TEDx. This is truly amazing. And all of our organizers are seniors, so for those underclassmen who are here, pressure's on to try to outdo this. If we could have the organizers come up, I think they deserve a real standing ovation. Bedford's high school spirit, something that was totally student-directed, student-run. They asked me four questions since from August to today. Everything else was totally on their own. So congratulations to them. Great, great, great work. So that concludes our night. Thank you for spending your Saturday night with us here in Bedford. I hope that you have a wonderful night, and I hope to see you next year at TEDx. Thank you.